Godot Tutorials is not sponsored by or affiliated with the Godot game engine. My name is Josie and I'll be your guide for this episode. I also have a website at godottutorials.com, so please feel free to check that out. In this series I will be going over the following. What is a game designer? The different hats of a game designer. The main goal of a game designer. What is the main problem game designers face? Lastly, what is the solution to that problem? So, what is a game designer? The dictionary definition of a game designer is a person that designs the rules, art direction, and contents of a game from beginning to end in the development life cycle. In a sense, if something is in the game designer must sign off on it. My personal definition of a game designer, however, is a person that crafts experiences. I like to think of game design as a partner dance. Any type of partner dance, it could be salsa, jazz, or even West Coast swing. In a partner dance, it's you and someone else. In many cases, it will be a leader and a follower. You, the game designer, are the leader, while the person playing your game is the follower. One thing to note is that all followers are unique. What I mean by that is that no two followers are the same. And so while you are dancing your dance, you must adjust yourself constantly throughout the dance. For the sake of your follower, you must dance in a way that your follower is comfortable with. If your follower tells you through body language you are doing too little, then do more. If your follower tells you through body language that you are doing too much, then pull back. But at the end of the dance, you will be judged. You will be judged on a scale of 10, which is the follower will ask you to dance immediately to the next song, or a 0, where the follower will never want to dance with you again and reject any attempts you may have on getting a second dance with them. It's tough, but that is your job as a game designer, to craft and design experiences that your players will love. Game designers have many responsibilities. Besides understanding level, combat, and artificial intelligence design, I believe a general understanding of the following will aid you in your game design journey. They are psychology, anthropology, storytelling, world building, history, architecture, business, communication, art, animation, music theory, usability testing, and programming. Out of all of these, the five I believe are the most crucial to game developers are world building, business, communication, usability testing, and programming. Now, the goal of a game designer is quite simple in theory. It's your job to determine the goals and vision of a game while simultaneously making sure that you don't stray away from your goals and vision during the process of the game development life cycle. The problem is, unlike partner dance where feedback is immediately given back to you, in game design, you can only get feedback until after you have a tangible object in which your players can play with. Basically, you need to build your toy out first. This leads to several problems. First, since you cannot test out your game ideas until you have a tangible product in your hand, you need to allocate resources to building your game. If you are a solo developer, this would mean dedicating your time, and even money, to building out your first tangible prototype. However, as with most plans, the first one usually never works out, so you must iterate. The more you iterate, the more time and money you spend. The more time and money you spend, the faster you run out of budget. This leads to a very serious problem, and that is game design may lead to cost overrun, also referred to as budget overrun. However, there is a solution that aids in avoiding this, that is understanding the planning and procedures of game development along with using game design techniques to aid in building and iterating games cheaply. Understanding game development and game design only mitigate failure and does not guarantee success. From here on out, we will go over things that fall into one of these categories, starting from the basics of games and game systems, all the way to planning out worlds and stories. Lastly, this series is made with the intention of inspiring, sharing knowledge, and breaking down barriers of entry. They are made simply to guide, not to tell you how to do things. Lastly, game design is a choice that only you can sign off on, so follow your heart and your gut. If something sounds wrong to you, then it most likely is. Okay, homework time. I want you to think of a game you want to make, and then pick an existing game that is close to the scope or quality you want to make. Then I want you to research who the game director of that game is, the amount of people that worked on that game, and the length of time it took for them to make that game. In addition, if you pick a game made by a solo developer or an indie team, then I want you to research more personal information such as living and financial conditions. After, contemplate on how you can achieve the same thing. This homework assignment is not to judge, but to showcase that some games you may want to build may have more to it than meets the eye. I will do a homework assignment as an example, but I will tell you the takeaway of it right now. It's that if you currently have a job, that you keep your job and don't quit on the sake of making a game. Okay, so here is an example homework, and I chose Stardew Valley, solo developer named Eric Barone. My source of reference is the book called Blood, Sweat, and Pixels by Jason Schreier, which by the way is a great book and I highly recommend you buy it. It's an eye-opener. Stardew Valley is a game made from 2011 through 2016. The creator Eric lived with parents for what seems like 1 year, then moved out and lived with his girlfriend who supported him by taking care of rent and food. This was achieved by working two jobs while simultaneously going to undergraduate school. After graduation in 2014, she was able to support Eric with a better job. Eric would spend about 12 to 15 hours a day, 9 hours of sleep time, 7 days a week. Eric did not hire anybody, neither employee nor freelancer, to create Stardew Valley. Eric got a deal with Chucklefish in late 2012 as a publisher, who handled all legal aspects of the game. Basically, Eric did not have to pay money out of pocket to legally protect everything to do with Stardew Valley along with marketing. Towards the end, Eric started getting lazy, some days refusing to work. So a few takeaways for me. With a full-time job, I don't have 12 to 15 hours a day. Since I am the breadwinner, I don't have the luxury of stopping. Perhaps even more so if I had children. However, a few ideas on possible solutions come to mind. One being finding a partner, or multiple partners. Perhaps finding employees or freelancers to add extra hours that I cannot give. Perhaps finding a publisher or bank that will loan money upfront. Even if I work on it alone, perhaps I should expect production time to be 10 years instead of 5 years. Well, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for subscribing and liking this video. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.